Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I'm your moderator, Samir Mehta, and this is session number 113. We will take you to the cath lab where we have another complex calcified coronary artery lesion to treat today, a Syntec score 55. But in addition to showing you this calcified coronary application, probably with the rotablation, we also have another guest in the cath lab, which I'll let Dr. Sharma introduce. Sameen, good morning.
Okay, good morning all. This is a different room. This is not even two, not even three. Now we are back to room one, which we actually used it at the time of our June symposium. We are done actually of the CCVVC, the CCC live cases, one in room four. But room one is the first time in 113 episodes.
It is one of the older rooms too.
Yeah, and then we've been going because the rest of the rooms and this areas undergoing construction and renovation. Right. With that, we are ready to start.
Our guest really needs no introduction, yes. But please tell us.
Yes, Dr. Roxana
Mehra. I'm not a guest.
Yeah, no, she's not the part, but anyway.
Roxana,
the guest
good morning.
For the CCC live webcast. Guest that okay. way. No, she's not. Of course, you're an integral part. She's here because of something which we are going to talk about with our expertise in the field in terms of coronary inflammation. So I really ready to start with the Anu, ready? We had taken some pictures. What are you doing now?
Sameen, what is the highest Syntec score you have treated?
Well, the many of them, you know, the post-CABG cases and so is really difficult, but about 65.
All right. So 55 is right up there
so
also.
It is right about there. And this is a very unique.
And in a young person.
Patient. Yeah, what are you doing?
No,
EDP. This case, that's why I wanted to make sure it's the valve. Yeah. Okay. So let's go with that. Actually, we start the slides. This week's Jack. Anu is very proud of that, right on the front cover with the bifurcate app being published in JACC, which is both hard as well as soft copy. And this is the developing a mobile application for global cardiovascular education. It required a lot of work by Anu's team and with the 2-3 fellows involved and really come up and then really show that data to Dr. Fuster that how it was validated that can be used to improve the education, and education is the focus of Dr. Fuster and of course the JACC really led to this publication, and they go through the process of app development and of course the central figure. Superb. Now the update is that 10,000 plus have been downloaded. Any later update then? No? It's about like 10,000 few hundred, but clearly our goal is when we get the silver jubilee, 25,000. And so, but making a big waves, any meetings I go, and I'm sure you have gotten such a positive feedback. Although since then, she had developed the octade and working on transeptade, and then of course for the tower aid for the coronary anatomy. Now, Anu, you want to make any point on this? That how proud you are with this, your first app getting to the JACC?
Yeah.
One of the highest impact cardiology journal.
Congratulations. This is, as Sameen mentioned, I travel widely and the feedback is extremely positive. People routinely use this when they are using any modification, any application of the bifurcation. So congratulations, and to come out in JACC, I think is just fantastic.
And I can tell you that India, and I'll ask Broxana to talk. In India, two times now we have gone to the meeting. One, I had the fellows course. You were there with our eternal heart conclave. And then the Sky, India Sky meeting. And both time I asked that how many have bifurcated app? And it's more than 60%, just close to 2/3 people raise the hand that they have downloaded. And of course, they give you the individual demographic.
I think we'll test this further with India Live also.
Yep.
Yeah,
yes.
I think what the crucial, and I think one of the things that I love about this app is the application being used in places where complex intervention is not that often used, and you really get comfortable in understanding how to treat bifurcation lesions in a one step, by two step, by three step. And she basically has, one of the things that's amazing is that she's figured out all of the details that if anything goes wrong or, you know, if a side branch closes or what, how the side branch, all the different possible algorithms are have been programmed in this app. I've used it. It's incredible. I think, you know, it's going to have a huge application for global education and hopefully improvement of patient outcomes.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's really what this is. And I want us to kind of put that into work in a project and a protocol.
Exactly.
With Dr. Kinney.
Exactly right, Roxana. In addition, I think one of the other practical benefits is you want to modify your technique, the tool is there ready for you to guide you with that too.
100%.
Okay, so we go with our supporters. Thanks and disclosures about the same. Now, this is a very interesting patient, 53-year-old. Patient is on hemodialysis and has extensive CAD as well as aortic stenosis. So he presented to Mount Sinai last year in November, October-November time frame. Had a cath outside, severe extensive CAD and severe aortic stenosis. Cath was not done at Sinai, but we have that. So went to surgery and surgeons found vessels so diffusely diseased and calcific. They said no bypass and just replace the valve. I mean, amazing. So this at this age, at 53 years of age, just replace the valve. The mild minimal LV dysfunction, EF was about 50%. So then he did good for about 11 months and now came back, presented to outside hospital again with non-STEMI and was transferred for further intervention. They didn't want to cath because we knew exactly what anatomy was. This is just high risk. You bring the patient here and then we did the angiogram and we compared with the old one. There's a lot of progression of the disease and it is a calcific, inoperable, three-vessel disease with syntax score of 50 plus. So culprit was proximal circumflex, which we can quickly go through. You want to show? So this is a circumflex.
Yeah.
There is a little bit of shadow, that total occlusion. Even nothing will go. Let's show the angiogram first. Nothing will go. It will require rotablation in non-STEMI setting. So we are done. We have published, actually, the rotablation in acute coronary syndrome. LED is a diffusely disease. There is a diagonal and ramus, both are old total. They were there. And then the right.
And this is where we are the right.
And this is the right.
Look at this right.
Much
corner.
Progression than before, what it was, but so calcific all the way.
I think this is one of the unusual ones where we have a lesion and a vessel deemed inoperable by the surgeon.
Right. And this, and particularly, with, you know, many times they leave it, a few disease in the elderly patient, it's a young person. But because they felt that entire vessel, they palpated that till the distal area, vessels are calcified, they say it will not take the graft. So this is where we are. Go back to our slide presentation. So valve hemodynamics, we didn't cross. Echo showed good valve in terms of the valve functioning. And so patient is super obese and where other risk factors are shown there. Patient good medical therapy, and also we did which is the part of the discussion today, the CRP measurement. At Mount Sinai, it's a routine for about 6-7 years now that all patients get the pre-procedure lab test, including lipids, besides regular chemistry, LDL, of course, and the CRP, and hemoglobin A1C, those who are diabetic. So that has been our database, which we modified in last 7-8 years. So we have the data, and that why I'm saying that, because this will come back to one of the article which we'll be talking. This patient had a CRP done last month. It was 58. But remember, that time patient had a non-STEMI. So one of the reason high CRP was the non-STEMI in this particular case. And of course, LDL is superb. It's less than 30. Has been on atorvastatin 40 milligram. These are the individual coronary which we already shown. Patient did well after the first intervention, but still have some angina. And today is for intervention of the right coronary, which you have seen here with multiple burr approach. We do step burr, I would say, in about 7-8% of cases, single digit, and about 1-2% we use three burrs. Actually, matter of fact, one patient yesterday, we used three burrs. So step burr approach in 7-8% single digit, high single digits, and three burr in maybe 1 to 2% of cases. So that will be the goal here today. So if we take it to a three vessel disease criteria in this particular case, it will be appropriate. This is non-inoperable anyway, and patient has non-STEMI. So by all the way, this will be appropriate case for intervention. So are we ready?
Sameen, this may be indeed a case that you will need more than two burrs.
Yeah.
Roxana is going to be talking to us about inflammation today.
Go a little bit higher.
No. Yeah, I think first they want to take you, show you.
Start the process and then we take it through.
Excellent. I think Amplatz guide is just the right one to start here with.
Also, what happened is we changed. Normally, we used to go with the Mark guide. This is the Medtronic.
The Sherpa guide?
Sherpa, because it will require a lot of support. It's a 7 French AL.75 with side holes.
I like their guides. It's
Wow, that's nice. That gives you huge support.
So now, same, I think if you see the angiogram here, this is the case where you will use over the wire system to wire,
right,
rather than go direct to rotavire.
Very
now, what do we do with the PDA? We leave it, right?
No, there is a lesion in the PDA also. If we can get a 1.5 burr there, we'll see how we work it out.
I don't know about that.
No, but that probably is supplying the most part of the heart.
Let's be happy if we do this proximal first.
Right.
Maybe you could
give me the fielder.
Yeah, this is a fielder. Yeah.
You could dilate that with a
nothing will open. No. You have to do rota. Either you leave it, or if you have to do something.
To do something
that's
but then it'll be a 1 to 5.
They could not bypass that. Because
1.5.
They
no, 1.25.
That even PDA was so
in the PDA, really?
Yeah. 1.25, says 1.5 will be too big.
No, it's a very big vessel. Now, what balloons we have selected, we always say that
three
whatever
five,
balloon you want.
3.5 high pressure balloon, 20.
Yeah, 3.5, 30.
Not 30, it's not going
30,
to make a
30.
Turn. Give
so
us
after,
20.
After multiple burr, we'll do 3.5, 30 high pressure. Okay, so we are ready to start with the calcific, this kind of calcium. I'm sure there is second way than fixing the, doing the atherectomy. Now, a lot of people say, well, I'll like to want to see that how much calcium it is. 3.5, 30. Burr, we don't know yet. We are based on the crossing, we'll decide.
Oh, she's crossing it beautifully.
This is the fielder.
Over the wire, with clearly that if your fine cross goes, then you go with the 1.5 burr, and otherwise 1.25. So wire went in.
Beautiful, Dr. Kinney.
Anu, no torquing device?
Yeah.
No, nothing.
Just the fingers. Okay. Yep. Expertise demonstrated.
You want to do 1.25 first?
Sameen, what would you say if somebody said they would like to try orbital atherectomy here?
Yeah, I mean, that's okay. That is perfectly fine. Only problem is, in our algorithm, if your vessel is 4 millimeter, which is it is actually, because in this case, I put a 5 for onyx in the circumflex.
Now, the rota extra support or rota
wire? Yeah, rota extra support. Rota extra support wire,
Rota extra support wire and 1.25 burr for the PDA.
You want to go down the PDA, doctor?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
yeah,
I think so.
We will show how to use DynaGlide and go to the
PDA.
Right,
that's an interesting way.
So let's just go through, but the point is that can you use orbital atherectomy? Yes, but look at the large size of the vessel. So maximum 1.25. Even at 120 RPM, 1000 RPM will give you 1.7, 1.8.
Closer.
Maybe 1.85
maximum,
millimeter lumen.
Maximum, Got it.
You're going to have to focus on her putting in the...
And Sameen, clearly somebody trying to use this cutting balloon or angiosculpt is really out of the league here, no?
Yeah. Oh, no, they won't go. I mean, clearly, these are the things what also, one fellow says that I want to try this. I said it's a -5 in interventional cardiology board. Because your cutting balloon or angioskull won't even make the first turn. Second, IVUS, you can do IVUS, but what question is,
what are you going to achieve with the IVUS?
Because so much calcium, that surgeons have palpated.
You're not going to get in there.
Right. And IVUS may not even go. So that is one of the big issue.
You saw that in the mid RCA, I had trouble getting the fine cross down. We had to do some torquing action. So IVUS would not have gone there.
Never. IVUS would not have gone.
This is called Abiomed Lady, Tarisha, that I'll be talking about in parallel.
You're already there.
Yeah.
But are you in the PDA?
Yes. See that?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we are in the PDA.
Now we'll take a 1.25 burr for the PDA.
And give me a 2.520.
After that, what will we do? 2 a burr will be a big jump, no?
No. We'll do a
1.75,
and then 2 or 2.15. So 3 burrs.
3 burrs here, yeah, because of that distal.
So why really we are changing the burr ratio?
If there was no PDA lesion there, you probably would go with a 1.5.
Absolutely.
That's just for the PDA.
I think that's 1.5 may be too much for the PDA.
No, I think it's too much, okay.
1.25 is probably okay. You just need to shave good. The
so calcium. So while they are setting it up, we can just briefly talk. So you saw it, the fine cross, regular fielder wire exchange to the rotaxial support, and we are riding with a 1.25 because of such a distal lesion and a small vessel. So what we are going to talk today is the two important aspects. One is the inflammation in the coronary atherosclerosis and impact of the residual inflammatory risk, RIR, we talk. And second is the emerging evidence for Impella-assisted PCI. The 3 papers and presentations done in the TCTE and published already in for the AKI, door to unloading in STEMI and National Cardiogenic Shock Initiative. So one of them is the inflammation. Inflammation actually started early 2000. This is the first paper which Henderson about the, it's not only the lipid, it's the inflammation causing the atherosclerosis, although there were some data quite a bit, but really take to the center stage in 2004 with this paper in NEJM. And basically combining that lipid is not only the LDL causing the plaque progression, also causing inflammation. And this actually has been shown. The recent paper about atherosclerosis and inflammation in the vasculitis and all that goes back. So it's not only atherosclerosis, it's the inflammation also. So put it together that of course the patient, and then you can image, and then you have biochemical markers. So inflammation came to the center stage largely because of the CRP assessment, because CRP is one of the simple measurement which you can do as a marker of inflammation anywhere in the body. Of course, for the coronary atherosclerosis, coronary, you do a special high sensitivity CRP. And this actually was a nice paper back then talking about as a high sensitivity CRP as a cardiovascular risk in disease. Also has shown the recent paper in JAMA Cardiology that patients who have psoriasis, if they develop aortic valve inflammation, so they also have a coronary artery disease. So any inflammation in the aortic vasculature was associated with FDG uptake imaging, very sophisticated, showing the inflammation, superadded inflammation, and out of proportion inflammation, editorial by our Jagat Narula on this. So coming back to the point, so what's shown that LDL trials, that it's not the LDL only. So once you have LDL or CRP, less than 70 or less than 2, there is an incremental benefit. Those were the various trials in the beginning showed that best results are when your LDL is less than 70 and CRP less than 2. That really led to this concept. And of course, the Jupiter trial we knew, LDL was therapeutic and those patients with high CRP were randomized to rosuvastatin versus placebo. So CRP really came to the equation in the day-to-day life in last few years and so. So this just to say before we go on to this intervention, so that is how we put nowadays. Atherosclerotic patients on statin, maximum statin, aggressive statin therapy, then LDL on treatment. If it is more than 70, you call it a residual cholesterol risk. Less than 70 means you achieve your target. And CRP less than 2, you call it a residual inflammatory risk or RIR, or if less than 2 is no residual inflammatory risk, although some people say this number could be 1. Roxana, you want to comment on while we are doing
Roxana, before you do that, please address the paradigm here. Why on aggressive statin this patient has a LDL less than 30 and a CRP of 55?
I mean, I think that's really sort of the dilemma that we have, and that if we just focus on lipids, we're missing about a whole nother paradigm, which is not just the lipid reduction, but also there is important inflammation that one needs to consider. In a patient like the one we just saw today, here is this patient on hemodialysis and came in with a high CRP during the throes of a non-STEMI.
Yep.
We don't know where it is today, but this patient obviously has not just atherosclerosis, but also some inflammation that surrounds it. His LDL is 29. You can't get much lower than that.
So
in the best possible scenarios with PCSK9s, you're getting down there in the 20s.
Assuming that the CRP is maybe not 55, but still elevated, you think it is coming more from the kidney disease or the NSTEMI?
Well, it's very possible. It's very hard to tease that out, as you can imagine. But I think what's more important is to now say there is a whole bucket of patients, actually, that we have to consider about their residual inflammatory risk and what to do for them. And as you know, right now, there's no treatment currently available for these types of patients. And the most recent methotrexate trial at the AHA wasn't really astounding. Now, Dr. Sharma is going to talk about the CANTOS trial, but unfortunately, that drug is an orphan drug at the moment and is not being used in these types of patients worldwide.
Okay.
So we are ready now. We'll tell us.
So we have the 125 bar. So if you can show the fluoroscopy, see that?
Yes, see it
what's
very
happening?
Nicely.
See, when I'm trying to get the burr, you see that it's in the guide. As I'm going in more, the guide is coming out. You see that? That is typical.
Yeah,
Would you be back?
The guide is coming out. So what you do in this situation, you leave it in the guide. You put it on Dyna. If you see here with the new...
Let's see how that new thing works.
You see that?
Here.
Rotopro. So you are on Dyna.
Anu, would you be pulling back the wire a little bit?
Yeah, we're doing it. Yep, we did already.
Do it together.
We did. On Dyna.
Yeah.
So now you have to press, right? You press the Dyna.
Yeah.
So now
this
is the only thing is, you have to press the Dyna and I will manually go forward. Okay, go press Dyna.
Good.
Yeah, stop there. Yeah. It still came out.
So this is very important step for people to understand.
That's the start now. It's a 1.25 bar.
Now we will start the rota.
Your guide is a little bit out, right?
It's okay.
Good.
But you'll put it back in. There you go.
Yeah, we know that first two lesions
it
will go by
burr.
Itself. Yeah.
They're going to go by.
But still, it was tight there.
Yes.
You feel
tight.
Some resistance there too? No. Okay.
Here, good. Little resistance. See, now you pull the wire back. That was bad.
Yeah. Fine.
You would not have pulled it.
Sure.
So now what we need to do is go forward with the Dyna.
Show here.
And once.
So we are going to do. Tight it here, very important. So tight here, then we are holding. These buttons will all change within few months. So right now, very
they
complex.
Can't see. Okay, can we make a focus here?
Yeah. Yeah, they're showing.
Nothing.
Good. Ready?
Okay. Good.
Yeah, see? So burr has been advanced.
Even then, the guide is coming out.
Yeah, good. Hold
okay,
it.
Stop
bring
that.
The guide. Bring the guide better.
No, it's not going anymore, right?
So now second is, what you do is you advance manually. You can see here, you're advancing the burr and you're pulling back the advancer knob.
Okay.
So that is, you know, there was published actually many years ago in CCI, this technique called Navatno. The guy who published that, but this will be good enough.
Okay, now the wire, I need the wire further because now it's at the lesion.
Come back a lot.
I would not have pulled the wire back.
Let's see. Let's take a little scene.
She's right. It's near the lesion.
It was pulled back too much.
And then once you go there, it will be advanced. Yeah. Good. So we need a proximal part. Good. That's okay. Keep going. Yeah. Look for a 1.75 attachment.
Can you push the wire for
that?
Yeah.
That's it. That's it. Now you got it.
34. 29. Not reaching now.
Yeah. You're not reaching or you just did,
no,
I think.
I don't think we are there at the...
Because it jumped a little. I think you did it.
So what I was doing is, I was manually going forward.
Uh-huh.
It broke.
Huh?
Broke.
Okay. Let's come out. It did the work.
I don't think so. We crossed it.
Did it?
Okay, let me try once more.
I think you got it.
Yeah.
No, it didn't cross the lesion. No.
Just about touching there, but not across.
Now, do you want to go forward again more?
I cannot. This burr is broken now. See?
Okay.
Okay, come on.
Okay.
Okay.
Anu, so why do you think it broke? Because of doing it manually rather than using the...
Manual.
Manual.
Manual pressure.
breaks the burr?
No, here. Teflon sheath.
Okay. I see.
Right? Pay attention. You're standing. Hey? You're holding your hand?
We still have the wire. Have it.
Why you went to Timbuktu?
Okay, here.
Help out.
Timbuktu.
Got it?
So we made at least...
Yeah, it opened up. It went there.
This goes
I
out.
I think the very distal probably we didn't get it, but excellent demonstration of the DynaGlide as well as the...
I don't know, why don't we go directly 2-0?
No, 175.
But you're not bringing 175 down below, Dr. Sharma.
No.
Why not go to 2-0?
I would go 2-0.
You see? The
you got it. Beautiful.
Nicely. Yeah.
It's a waste of bar. Give 2-0.
I think you'll be fine with 2-0.
Yeah.
Now, other question is, we have 7 French. If you want to go
you
to bigger one.
You cannot go bigger than 2-0 now.
Yeah.
So I was wondering why you are saying.
What's the difference between 175? Yeah, I get it. Because you're on a 7 French.
No, but we never taught. We're always teaching. Never jump more than 0.5.
Okay, then do 175. But then we are done. After that, we are done.
Yeah, that's okay. This will remain in the back burner.
I'm also today privileged to welcome several interventional cardiologists from Mexico. I know there are people joining us from Acapulco, Leon, from Querétaro, and Culiacán. Welcome to all of you.
Welcome, yes.
And Roxana, we've been making big inroads into South America over the last few months. We routinely have people, I know you know these several physicians from Buenos Aires, Argentina, from Fundacion Favalaro, as well as ICBA, Dr. Bellardi and his group. And also, routinely, we have several physicians from Brazil who join us from São Paulo and Uberlândia, including Dr. Botelho.
Wonderful. We have wonderful friends in South America,
yes,
all over the globe now with Dr. Sharma's course.
Yeah, this really is a great joy. Happened again at the AHA. I was at a poster, and several people came and talked about the live cases.
But Dr. Mehta, we also have to, on this Thanksgiving Day, be thankful to you for being, you're so loyal and you're here all the time.
113
such a wonderful
episodes.
Such a wonderful moderator. We're so lucky that you are always doing this, and your friendship and loyalty is something we're very thankful for.
Thank you so much for the kind words, and both with Anu and Sameen, as well as with you, it's been a great privilege coming here.
Okay, ready? I'm gonna check this thing outside. Okay, going on. Check it.
So,
straight with the 2-0.
Good.
I don't know that if I might still like my pedals, Dr. Sharma. No?
Well, I mean,
do you like this new Rota Pro?
The probably for younger generation, I think maybe better.
Really? Do you? I mean, it looks a little confusing with all the buttons. Yeah. So.
No, but they had to simplify. They had to make it simpler, and which is already suggestions have been made. Engineers have changed it, but you know, anything you do, you have to go back to the product development with the FDA. So they're waiting for the FDA. Yeah.
Sameen, so you decided with the 2-0?
No, this is a 1.75, and we wanted to keep
same
hour that don't jump more
exactly
than
exactly the guidelines. Yeah.
Yeah. That don't go more than 1.5 jump. Good.
No, but let's go further so we can go down.
Okay. Once again, you use DynaGlide to get
to
you.
Go it, yeah. Okay. And that is what we always tell. If you have difficulty, don't get too crazy about the push and pull. Go with the DynaGlide.
Got it. Okay, getting stuck at the. Okay, we are beyond the mid portion of the first segment. And
you have run through, right?
Yeah. So in between, after 20 seconds, you wait, come back, and try to stop the burr in a non-lesion segment. Don't leave it in the lesion because that will cause more spasm, more platelet activation, and so that was done just here. Go.
So are you planning to stent that PDA?
Yeah, definitely.
Because it looks pretty good.
but high resources, as you know, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did. Okay. No more.
And what burst speed are you there, Sameer?
It's 150.
Yeah, actually, it's a very interesting with this no Rota Pro. Mm-hmm. The VC, one, they usually start with 150. Second, because that's what I've been telling them, that 150 should be the speed. Second, the drop in RPM somehow is less.
That's interesting.
The whatever they have set it. Remember, CSI also, when you make it 80, there's no drop in RPM. The machine compensates mm-hmm. for any resistance to keep 80,000 RPM.
I don't think that's a good thing, believe me. That will give rise to a lot of wire bias and perforation.
Blood pressure came up and then some.
You need to have the idea of the resistance and RPM drop. If the machine adjusts itself, so these people will keep going.
Mm-hmm.
No, but what happened is the same. That if it is having tough, you will give, no, adjust in the sense that until there is a tremendous resistance, then machine is going to make a separate noise, like no. Zzzz.
No, yeah, but not the OA.
No, OA does also. No. In a very calcific lesion, OA makes the same noise also. Pull back a little wire.
But I don't think you are a younger generation like you call is used to the zzzz noise.
Go.
Nice.
Roxana, with this patient with the continued elevated CRP, assuming that number is correct, would you manage him differently?
Well, I mean, I just think, unfortunately, at the moment, we don't have much more to do for this patient except for a very, very in-depth surveillance.
Would you add a second statin?
The statin is already, his LDL is already 29.
No, I'm trying to address the CRP here.
Yeah. For that, but you need anti-inflammatory medication, statin anymore.
No. Yeah.
Even the data on ezetimibe as well as PCSK, they're not strong.
High dose aspirin?
No, but those patients are. But they're not that strong for the CRP, mm-hmm. it's only for the LDL.
Yeah.
Sameen, at this point, you want to continue your.
Or what's going on here now? You're going to put
first
in your wire?
First,
you're
going to dilate with a 2.5 balloon distally, and then
put your stent
putting
there?
The run through wire, PDA, but put a stent.
But if you need to stent PDA, you need a guy, Godzilla.
But can I ask you a question? Yes. Why not stent proximally to open and give you a, and then go down distally and stent?
No, that could be a
thought to do that.
No, but what will happen is
if you don't want to bring in a Godzilla.
No, even then, it's not going to go without Godzilla. So there's no other option but Godzilla.
Okay.
No, just coming back to the point, I think the important in some cases when really very proximal, the guide issue. We take the rota off.
Right now, let's go.
The balloon? Where's the balloon?
You need to give, you have 7 French Godzilla?
Yeah.
No, where the balloon?
No.
Yeah, give some, 100 questions. Yeah, once we are dilating there, so let's just go through the didactic discussion mm-hmm. while the goal right now is dilating. The PDA put a 2.5.
What stents you have?
No, it was, other side we put a Onyx.
Why did you do that?
5.0. Vessel was 5.5. Yeah, it's a 5.0.
Already reached
So therefore, just let's go through this now. So now question is, what is the issue here? The residual inflammatory risk and residual cholesterol risk. So these are the two trials which have been done, prove it and improve it. And of course, the registry data shows basically that almost about 30 to 45% of patients will have a residual inflammatory risk in addition to normal cholesterol level. So this is a very interesting observation. So therefore, we know that all these trials have shown bringing the LDL down to less than 70, still event rate was 10 to 15-20%. That means that LDL alone is not going to answer that question and problem. It has to be the anti-inflammatory medication. And therefore, targeting inflammatory pathway for the treatment of cardiovascular disease by Paul Ridker has taken the lead role in that position. And then, of course, very complex, but numerous drugs. So there are many publications. So I found this picture very interesting and going through various pathways. So basically, in nutshell, the interleukin 1, which goes through interleukin 6 and then CRP. that basically is the common pathway, and during this cycle, various agents work, and there are various names which are even tough to pronounce. I would not bore anybody that I'm not a scientist on this, but I'm just providing the best available data of the anti-inflammatory property or anti-inflammatory concept which is coming up in the literature at this time and so. So key is the first one, it was the for the interleukin 1 inhibitor, canalicumab. How do you pronounce it?
Canakinumab.
You know, it's a very tough. But it showed that did decrease the CRP, didn't have any effect on the LDL. Right. Then other interleukin measures all decreased by various doses. It was given every 3 months interval, 48 months trial, 150, 300 dose, and turns out to be 150 was the best dose, except more patients who were on the therapy developed more infection, non-fatal but higher infection, so and low platelet count. It did affect the WBC count and platelet count, and individual endpoints are shown here. 150 seems to be the best dose. Then the second, so that was the CANTOS trial. Second one, which Roxana just mentioned, the SIR trial, the low dose methotrexate, prevents of atherosclerotic event, very complex, 15 to 20 milligram, and the patients were followed, again, large number of patients, and presented in AHA and came in NEJM simultaneous publication. What did show that somehow initial data were there for the methotrexate, but it does not affect the CRP or interleukin level. Mm-hmm. But that is surprising, because this major trial was done on the basis that this dose of methotrexate will have shown to decrease the coronary sinus when they did a measurement of these inflammatory markers and so on and so forth, and intravenous. So that they did not see in this particular study, which is a big disappointment, because any of these mega trials are done after the lot of homework.
I mean, I have to say, I was disappointed when I saw that the results are negative, because it would have been a cheap drug to address an important issue like what we have in this patient. But in some ways, I'm really glad we're not offering patients methotrexate. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like a cancer drug, and it kind of makes you feel like a little bit, okay, I'm glad I'm not having to deal with that.
And there was actually slightly higher incidence of infection as well as skin cancer.
That's right.
Non-significant is skin cancer. You don't want to use it, but I just to say that, no, I'm not disappointed the results were overall negative.
Yeah.
Well, I'm disappointed that even the biochemical markers were not different.
Yeah, that's right. That's key. A disappointing part. Maybe it wasn't the right dose.
Yeah, because that was the basis of the whole trial.
Yeah.
They did a lot of experimental work, animal work, coronary sinus work, mm-hmm. to see that methotrexate inhibited in acute coronary syndrome, interleukin and CRP. Very selective measurements. But
well, they didn't want to hurt patients, so they worked very, very hard for the dose finding. And I think, you got to give Paul Ritker a lot of credit. He, this would have been a cheap drug if it was available to address this issue. And I think it's fantastic that he's going through all of this and
doing this
work.
So therefore, this is methotrexate is bye-bye. So these are the two trials, CANTOS and CERT put together. CANTOS, yes, but only problem is who manufactures it and who will be the...
So CANTOS, which the canakinumab is manufactured by Novartis. It's an orphan drug that's currently being used in orphan diseases. But it is expensive, obviously. And when in this particular trial, CANTOS, it was a significant reduction in MACE. And there was also significant reduction in cancer-related deaths, which was unbelievable, and reduction in cancers. And I think that has made them sort of go in that direction. Unfortunately, FDA did not approve this. October 18th, I think, was the PDUFA date. And the panel and the FDA did not move forward to, there was no panel, but the FDA did not approve the drug. So it's unfortunate we don't have right now any kind of a treatment for a patient like the one we have today.
And this is a monoclonal antibody, as you see.
Yeah.
So then there were data on colchicin.
Right.
Another cheap drug, same basic group, which have been shown by the coronary sinus and acute coronary syndrome, giving colchicin, decreased level. Same thing they did for methotrexate and canalicum, and of course, some data to show lower event rate, change in plaque. And this is the major trial which has been ongoing or completed, will be presented soon. Colchicin, basically low-dose low-dose colchicin for cardiovascular outcome and many others, because inflammatory target, inflammation is being focused at this time. That led to our main discussion of today, the data which came up on the residual inflammatory risk, RIR, and impact on clinical outcome in patients after PCI by Dr. Rakshana Mehran's the area, and particularly making this, bringing to the center stage, which has not been published ever before, RIR during PCI, not in the CAD patients, but in the PCI patients.
So, Rakshana, well, and I want to first of all say that I was just lucky to have this access to this kind of data that Dr. Kinney and Dr. Sharma very long ago thought about before I even reached here. They've always paid attention to a patient's residual inflammatory risk. A C-reactive protein is actually obtained in most of our patients who come to PCI. It's part of the labs that we do here. And so I took advantage of that based on the fact that this database that we now have, which is actually connected to our electronic health records, and we have anytime a patient has a CRP, we actually look at that. So take a look at what we were able to do. Our PCI registry from January of 2009 to 2016 was probed, and we had over 34,000 patients and 23,000 or so unique patients, 34,000 procedures. And what we actually looked for in this paper is how many of these patients have two paired CRPs that are 4 weeks apart. So we programmed that into the database, and we then categorized the patients who had baseline and another CRP at least 4 weeks apart. And the baseline was always at the time of PCI, and then the one after that was about 4 weeks apart. And what we did is we categorized these patients into those who have a persistent high elevation of C-reactive protein, those patients with a persistent high residual inflammatory risk. And interestingly enough, some 30% of the patients that came to this who had happened to have two CRPs drawn actually fell into this. Those who had increased CRP, in other words, they came in at low and went up high, and then attenuated those who had high and then had it lower, and then compared to the referent group, which was a persistent low. And it's interesting to see the fluctuation of CRP in our patient population. There's only about 37% of the patients who actually just have a persistent low residual inflammatory risk. And that just, it makes you kind of think about this a little bit. So once we had that, we look at their baseline characteristics, and you could see here, basically there are some differences, but very interesting to see that these patients have, large numbers of patients in whom we have a very, very interesting outcome data out to 1 year. The most important finding of this paper, which was very much underlines the theme of inflammation and why we as interventionalists have to pay attention to this, is that there was increased mortality, increased MI, increased MACE overall, and that's the yellow line on top, with the highest risk in those patients who had persistent high residual inflammatory risk. This was a very, very significant finding. We were able to get it published at the European Heart Journal. And this was despite what their LDL looked like. And it was very, very important to note. And you see here the components of MACE and where you are. And this slide really does show that gradation of risk of reduction of MI, the gradation of risk and reduction of death in those patients whose CRP goes back to normal or have a low C-reactive protein.
The only question was, there was no difference in stent thrombosis.
Yeah, no.
So that's okay, right?
Yeah, that's fine. I'm not so sure that's really something that, what's more important is the hard endpoints of death and MI.
Absolutely.
And MACE, and really driven by that, pretty much. And I think you see those all here, all significant values for the important components of MACE.
Even in the LDL less than 70.
And even so in the LDL less than 70.
Yeah.
Very, very
in
important.
Appendix, yeah.
Because, and I think for this patient, you can kind of think about this particular patient with an LDL of 29.
Yeah.
If his next CRP is still high, we're going to worry about this patient and do all kinds of things, make sure that everything that he's very, very closely surveyed. He's only 53 years old. So you could see this here, despite the low LDL in the levels that we want, and probably we need to go even lower in these patients as we have with this particular patient. So this is our central figure, and I think I really like that, going from green to the different shades of orange and into the red. And really, the red is those patients with the persistent high residual inflammatory risk at a very high risk of mortality. Their hazard ratio of death is 3.5 times more than the referent group, which had the low, persistent low CRPs in both measurements. We were very proud for this paper, and really, I have to again congratulate Dr. Kinney and Dr. Sharma for their vision long, long ago that this was an important biomarker to kind of follow patients with, and I know they use it in their practice very, very closely.
And this is actually the masterpiece figure, puts everything together.
Yeah.
Phenomenal. Great job. Now, Anuk, we can go to the slides now very quickly. I mean, the fluoro. Yeah. So tell us what you did. What is going on now?
I think I can tell you we're going to change to this.
You didn't go to
new
a
guide.
20.
You like
the guide is
huh?
rock solid.
You didn't need, you didn't need a Godzilla.
That, I didn't need to have to have a Godzilla.
What is stent in the PDA?
We put a 2.5, 12, 16, sorry, 2.5, 16 promos. And
just
I needed to show you something that
just
I would
before
like
that, you did not go to the larger burr after the 175.
No.
Okay.
There are a couple of things. Yeah, you missed all that. Okay, good. Let's go back. So this is where we were. This is the 2.5 high pressure 22. All
distally.
The atmospheres are 22 high pressure balloon. So this opened. And then this is our 3.030, 22. But this is the next I wanted to show you. 3.0 again. Not 3.0, 3.5. At 22 ruptured. You see that?
Yeah.
No, this is the first one that ruptured.
Yeah.
Essentially telling us one that maybe it was used multiple times or there is a calcium spicule sticking out, ruptured the balloon. So we went with 4.0, 30, again 22 atmospheres, and this is what we got. Of course, whole vessel we dilated, but this is fully expanded. After that, we have the double wire. We have the rotavire still in the PDA as well as the run-through wire. This is, we place the stent in the PDA, and this is something I would need to show you, is that then you pull the rotavire back, but you don't need to take it out completely out of the vessel because you need the body wire for your other stents. So we place this stent, see? You see the body wire? Leave it there, and then we placed our next stent, same. The wire was still there.
You had the 2.75?
No, this is a 4.0 now.
In the PDA?
PDA, no, we put a 2.5, 16.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Okay.
So I think the big teaching point, though, Dr. Kinney, is that you saw that she went and she post-dilated the PDA, but then didn't go quickly to a stent. She dilated the entire vessel with the largest balloon possible, even though when the balloon ruptured, she didn't come out and say, okay, let me put the stent in now. She still went and did a very, very good dilation of that vessel to make the delivery of the stent to the PDA simple. And you saw what she did with the wire, keeping it still there for her next delivery. I think these are all really important teaching points here.
And one to just add, as you ask whether did we go to a bigger burr. So key is, when you are in doubt, leave the rotor wire, put your wire side by side, use your balloon. If balloon does not open up, and knowing that you have a room for a bigger burr, you go change it to the burr, you take the wire and balloon out. If it opened, like in this case, we didn't need to go to the third burr.
Yeah, so now the other question is same. It opened everywhere, but the proximal part ruptured. If I was unhappy that it had not opened up properly, then we would have gone with the flex tomb there. We would have gone with the 4.0
exactly.
flex tomb. Yeah, that would have been the next step, but then 4.0 22 opened up very well. And I think an important point is the same. The reason we are going over this point is that if you take the rotavire completely out and now your distal RCA stent is not going, you will have to use a double wire, or the body wire. Now you have to use
or
go
guide wire.
Yeah, guidelines. So you're increasing the steps. So what we're trying to teach you is minimize the steps and come out of this complex case with fewer steps.
And right, but also you are really following a specific regimen and you're not making shortcuts to show I can do it. Just how you do it all the time, step by step. It's really wonderful.
But the step by step is the same that you have to do with this, steps, maybe 12 steps, maybe 14 steps.
Of course.
If you don't follow that, you'll end up with 28 steps.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So you've got to follow those steps.
Some questions,
yes,
people?
Yes, several questions, actually. The first one about the case, again, this is a demonstrably severe calcification despite our not using the ultrasound for various reasons. Yeah. Why not go with the largest burr?
But clearly, remember the two things. The purpose of the largest burr is what? You are going to decalcify. Mm-hmm. And if you take a burr to artery ratio, we did a trial called Stratus, mm-hmm. STRATUS, mm-hmm. where we make a burr to artery ratio of 0.8 and above, and that clearly have a high restenosis, high CK release. So bigger burr has a more chance of causing more slow flow.
Right, this but patient, in this case, you're not going to be achieving a 0.80 with the...
No. I'm just saying that's therefore, what I say, my message is different. My message for atherectomy user is, use the smallest allowable, I would say smallest maximal size burr allowed for that lesion. What does that mean? So you have 3-0 vessel, your burr size should be 1.5. Period. Your 4-0 vessel, your burr size should be maximum 2-0, 0.5. You don't go beyond that. Beyond that, of course, rarely. Yesterday we did. We use a 1.5, 1.75, 2.15. Three burrs in one particular case, which is vessel was barely 3.75 millimeter vessel. So rare cases, but otherwise you go with the minimum allowable burr because you just need to modify, cut that in interelastic calcific lamina so that your balloon will expand.
Completely.
So that's the goal. Bigger burr, more slow flow.
No, I think more important is you have a calcific lesion, right? You have a calcific lesion. We're not going deeper cuts. All you have to do is chip the calcium, which is closer to the lumen. Once you do that, subsequent balloon expansion will be easier. I think that is what we showed on our OCT paper, comparison of rota versus OA, where you see when we did OA with higher speed, it did give deeper cuts because it was going deep into the internal elastic lamina, and that is the one that gives rise to the risk of a perforation of the using this device.
Excellent. Sameen, coming back to your, absolutely, I think it's a landmark paper to extrapolate this data from 35,000 patients over almost 10 years. Roxana, what... Is CRP the only measurement, or should substrate of the patient, we should be chasing the interleukin levels too?
Well, we didn't obviously do that, and CRP is a simple measurement. It's available everywhere.
How is the correlation between the two?
You need to put another one.
Interleukin measurements. It was just the CRP. In a multivariate model, though, that we ran, residual inflammatory risk was a significant predictor of outcomes down the line. This was a very, very significant thing to have two elevated C-reactive proteins over time is just not a good thing for the patients.
Yeah, and just to say, those interleukin and so in the regular plasma level are very small measurements, so you have to be very selective. So you go to coronary sinus, you go to renal vein, so really to see the production, so those are not practically possible. Be done, but practically possible is like almost non-measurable in the routine blood.
That's right.
You have to be organ-specific blood you have to draw for those. But and also at the same time, it turns out to be your final pathway interleukin is working through the CRP.
That's right, exactly.
So your CRP goes down, your IL-1, IL-6 will go down, and that has been shown consistently. Consistently now, the drug may not bring down like methotrexate any of the levels, but there was no discordant that interleukin went down and CRP did not go down. So they both go simultaneously because of the overall the mechanism of action in that pathway. So we have put two stents,
Now, you're doing post-dilation and then imaging, right?
Yeah, clearly. So while we are doing a post-dilatation, we can go through this, sum up on this very interesting topic. Next, and this was a learning for me also about the inflammation, and very nice editorial by Paul Ritker. You know, the paper
for
came.
For our paper, I was very proud of that.
And the European Society of Cardiology, which is at this time the highest subspecialty impact journal with about 21 the impact plus impact factor, and say that has the time finally come to measure CRP in primary and secondary CV prevention. As you know, Ritker is working on last 18 years to make this as a streamlined, I don't know whether it still have come to the mainstay, and so and so forth, because even in the latest cholesterol guideline, they talk about more about the calcium score, not with the CRP. They're not talking about CRP. So this is a very good way. So basically, we need to have an LDL as well as CRP in both to bring down on patients on statin. But I had done it very simple. And this is my creation, that all these trials have shown the LDL on one side, CRP on one side, statin works. Very good. So our target is you want to bring LDL to less than 70 and CRP to less than 2. But you cannot do it. So on this side, on the LDL to bring it down, you go to ezetimibe and put a PCSK9. On the right side, you cannot bring the CRP down. That's where the role of the new anti-inflammatory therapy will come in, whether it will be the interleukin-1 antibody or will be a colchicine and so on and so forth. So I think this is my central figure.
That's very nice. I like your central figure, Dr. Sharma.
Keep that slide on. Tell me, what will you do for this patient?
In this, only problem is, in this particular case, as such, we just know. Remember, in our science, always, first we know what the problem is. Then we come up to the answer. Right now, we know what the problem is, but we do not have any answer.
No, his CRP was related to MI.
But I'm telling you,
his CRP may still be higher.
Other thing is, did we know, because he's a dialysis patient, that CRP could be always high?
No, but not 58.
Not 58, so that's related to MI.
Today, CRP will be low.
We'll check. We don't know. I mean, we check it and we'll give the report of the repeat CRP based on your paper.
We'll give it to this patient. But you know, what you make a very good point, because now they're developing these anti-inflammatory agents for this, but it has to be targeted and the safety profile has to be there. You can't reduce inflammation and then have the patient have an infectious death, you know, which was some of the issues in CANTOS. There was a, you know, it wasn't a perfect trial. It did have some safety issues. So, and that's, so those are the kinds of things that we have to kind of continue to work on.
Roxana, are you able to, on the basis of the information you shared regarding the residual inflammatory response, are you able to speculate on the post-surgical patients?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, it's to me, I believe that we really should be looking at that, obviously. I don't know that we know much about the our surgical patients, and I think any patient who has cardiovascular disease, understanding what their inflammatory risk is, should be in your armamentarium of how you treat these patients and what you do as far as surveillance and what you do. Work really, really hard in those patients to bring their LDL really, really down, and then follow them very, very closely until we get therapies that are available for these patients.
Excellent address to a very, very pertinent topic. Sameen, you want to quickly finish your second topic too?
So let's see the picture, then they will be ready with IVAS.
We still have another topic?
Yeah, we have one more topic. Yeah, but that's a little simpler. This is the latest one.
I don't know about that. That's a very controversial topic you're bringing up.
This is all controversy and the latest. Controversy and latest, which is published in last 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks. Beautiful.
That
nice. Very nice.
You want to give some vasodilator?
A little bit of slow flow.
Give a little vasodilator, believe me. In this case,
it's hypotensive.
Then give nipride and so. So anyway, so you saw it last picture. You want to play? Can you play once again? So while you're doing, so we have about another 5 minutes while getting IVAS ready.
Anu, what was the largest balloon and the highest inflation pressure which you used?
We are 4.5 at 22.
Excellent. Yeah. So almost 5.0.
Proximal.
Right, in the proximal.
I mean, you could even use even,
yeah, looks even a little even another 5.4,
but that's right. We'll see based on the IVAS. But now you have the IVAS. IVAS will tell you what IVAS told most of the trial, that you end up using a bigger balloon and high pressure.
Yeah.
So let's see whether it's going to be true here or not. Okay, quickly go to the slides, please. So let's go to the second point. is the data on the impeller-assisted PCI. One is the acute kidney injury. It started with the major paper in circulation research, that patient, high-risk patient who had an impeller versus no impeller, no balloon pump in those cases, was associated with lower incidence of AKI. And this is, again, the what was the predicted AKI based on the Roxana Mehran's score. They use your score in this overall paper. This was the study design and so on and so forth. Now then they put a CVAD, which is the observational study of the impeller, also show the similar outcome that using impeller-assisted PCI, you have a lower kidney injury. So your rise on serum creatinine is much lower when you use impeller in these cases. So that was your, so overall puts it together.
The IVUS, no?
Just wait 1 second there. So basically overall seems to be that impeller AKI is favorable in all the scenario which had been used compared to the protected one and so. So why it is? Probably better flow in these high-risk patients. Yeah.
Okay, good. Start the IVUS.
Okay, let's go to the IVUS now. They should be able to show three screen. Or anyway, let's see the one screen is good enough. Yeah.
Okay, pull them back.
Okay. It's a distal vessel.
Lot
can
of
we show at least two of them?
Still.
Can we show two screens or no? Too much.
Floor? Yeah, but anyway. It's coming from distal.
This here is the comes stent. The stent, I think.
Yeah, distal stent.
Beautiful, Dr. So Kinney. Very nicely opposed.
I cannot have that there is an unopposed stent.
Let's see.
Well, that's why you're doing IVUS.
No, I think the stent will be, it will not be unopposed. It could be unexpanded in the mid-RCA level. That's
the only
thing.
The proximal.
Yeah, the proximal just around the bend.
Yeah.
But look at this.
Yeah, so far beautiful.
It's sticking
so
out.
So far gorgeous.
But show it on the floor. Guys, can we show the floor also?
I can tell you. OCT would have been done by now.
Here it comes.
Yeah, right now we are in the middle. Good.
Very nice. So far so good. I see a flawless stent procedure, Dr. Kinney.
Yeah. Yeah, very nice symmetrical expansion.
Now this is where.
No, gorgeous.
Good, nice. That is where we thought will be, but well opposed.
A little maybe.
Yes. Little under expansion, but no, nicely.
No. It's not
I
under
think
expansion.
You're good.
Yeah.
Not because of good. The calcium. It's yeah. unopposed.
I think
okay.
you're
okay.
good.
Beautiful. Good. Case is done.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Good job by the fellow.
Yeah. They are actually two fellows, Ruchir Patel and Deepika Mishra. Though you heard little yelling, screaming, which is part of it. Because if they are a little slow, that's the usual. But that is how the catecholamines keep moving. So going to take the last picture, and then we'll go through two other points.
I just want to say one point. I know you want to run into this, but about the AKI, I think it's a very intriguing concept. But please let's not say that impeller prevents AKI until we have more solid evidence.
Please.
I think. Testing it, and I think that you know, Dr. Sharma, that I'm readjusting the risk score because and why that is the Moran risk score was published in 2004,
but they're using
and
that.
We are reclassifying it in a way to make sure that the rates are comparable to what goes on now. In those days, hydration wasn't part of the full armamentarium, so those rates were a lot higher than what we're seeing today, Dr. Sharma. So we are reclassifying the risk score to better understand what's going on in the modern day of prevention of AKI. I don't think the risks are 58%. You don't see
but
that
that's
anymore.
Your risk. But based on your risk score. But anyway.
No, but you understand that. It was based on a patient population that never saw hydration.
Yeah.
Today we hydrate everybody, and those rates have come down.
Yeah.
And I think it's great, but I think it's important that we don't go around saying after this case that, oh, let me put an impeller to reduce AKI.
And your pre-risk, instead of balloon pump, you have to use impeller also.
But balloon pump, yeah, exactly. So we have to really the kind
just
of...
Let's look into our database.
No, we are doing that now.
Dr.
Sharma.
Yeah, what is left?
Dr. Kinney, we're doing that as
angiogram point of view, show that final. Yeah, good. Beautiful. And you saw the IVUS and so fantastic result.
Well, Sameer, the observation I have about today's case, I think your outstanding discussion was possible mainly because of the very steady hands of Anu as the operator.
It's very
true. really, this is amazing. These are such difficult cases. This extremely calcified lesion with the compulsive and beautifully demonstrated rotablator techniques was possible just because of the expertise. Superb case.
Truly, this was not a bifurcation, although you can say PDA, but was not true bifurcation. Right. You know, our highest viewed case, you know exactly, the 30,000 hits is the bifurcation LED diagonal calcific lesion.
Right.
That is the highest viewed case, total 30,000 hits on that, 31 plus.
Did you wrote a both?
Well, we have to, yeah. Sameen, maybe next time you should bring to us the latest statistics about our viewers.
Absolutely.
Too.
Yeah. So let's quickly finish it next 2 minutes. The second was presented was door to unload in STEMI. Your basically concept was that you immediately go and do the PCI, but you still have a slow flow microvascular obstruction and so, and there are baseline data. So, and this is a done
Somebody
work done
the
in the basic science lab showing that LV unloading by putting an Impella in swine model is associated with less myocardial ischemia and promotes overall cardio protection. So this led to the basis that maybe if you unload, rather than just putting the unloading and at least unloading for 30 minutes before the myocardial injury, it will give rise to a less smaller infarct size. So concept was there basic, that led to this overall study. Basically, which led to the pilot study of 50 patients. What they did is, STEMI patient put an Impella and waited 30 minutes. Second group put an Impella and did the PCI right away. So key, the gap was 30 minutes for the primary PCI, and basically data shown here, original, the time-wise, of course, in the delayed group, you have a higher, the door to balloon time, which is expected because the additional 30 minutes were added, and this is the infarct size. Was identical between two groups. One is the immediate versus delayed revascularization, and the individual endpoints of the CMR identical. There was a little bit less microvascular obstruction. So now, to me, plus and minus, people are very excited about that, oh, unloading didn't do a harm. I mean, I don't know whether that's the right statement, but they were very happy that say, oh, unloading, proof of concept has been done, did not cause any harm, even waiting 30 minutes, and that leading to paper published, accepted in circulation, and then leading to a major pivotal randomized trial, which will be ongoing. So you want to comment on it?
Yeah, so, yeah. I mean, I love the concept of translational medicine, of the work that Naveen Kapoor has done in the basic lab, showing that an unloading might reduce microvascular injury and improve, hopefully, because we have, all of us, have opened LADs in patients, got to the patient, and then the LV does nothing. And so we want to get to that next level. So I love the idea that maybe unloading has something to do with this. What I'm concerned about this trial is that the standard of care is not there, Dr. Sharma. Shock patients were excluded. These are regular healthy guys with an anterior wall MI who were randomized, who got Impella.
Yep.
What we needed is an arm with no Impella, with a radial axis STEMI, the way it's supposed to be, in the standard of care best possible scenario, to now say, okay, this is safe to do. The safety has to be that, because Impella is not without delaying the time to perfusion either, because it is delaying a little bit, not much.
No, it delayed 30 minutes.
30 minutes, exactly. Yeah. And then there was a delay. And so what I love about the pivotal trial, if you go now to the pivotal, is this the pivotal?
Yeah.
That the pivotal trial doesn't have Impella. There's an arm. There's a true arm that just goes straight to immediate PCI.
No LV unloading,
And no LV unloading. Right. And I think the other the other side is just really unloading.
Yeah,
and
unloading,
I think
for
that
30 minutes.
That
this is
pivotal
it.
Trial is a beautiful study. And I have to congratulate Naveen and Abiomed for actually pushing forward the concept.
Yeah. And then lastly is the cardiogenic shock initiative, which basically started by Bill O'Neill, showing that the shock always had been the issue. There is the Abiomed Impella quality program, and they found the PA catheter use, Impella CP, all these are associated with Impella use pre, they're all associated with a better survival. And the initial Detroit cardiogenic shock has taken the national initiative. Overall showed that 76% survival in these small number of patients with the 50 of them. And then now it has gone to the entire country and they're evaluating and they of course keep presenting the data on shock initiative. And basically what we learned now that by using the Impella in majority of time pre-PCI, 88% survival, and right heart cath is kind of mandatory in all these patients and so on and so forth. And lactate is a very important predictor. And of course, they have a nice algorithm when to explant these patients, so and so forth. And that really lead to our best cardiogenic shock survival data at present and so. So just to sum up, that coronary inflammation is playing a substantial role in prognosis of CAD patients, especially after high-dose statin use. Based on a large registry data from Mount Sinai, residual inflammatory risk has also shown to play an important role, or I would say persistent RIR, role in prognosis of PCI patients. In near future, targeted therapies beyond high-dose statin will be incorporated in our routine clinical practice in management of CAD patients. Second, there are numerous emerging data for Impella-supported PCI in reducing AKI in high-risk PCI and its early use in cardiogenic shock patients with resultant improved survival. The concept of ventricular unloading before primary PCI has been evaluated with no adverse safety signal and will make the basis of a pivotal large randomized clinical trial. So question number one, following are the agents which act on inflammatory pathway of coronary atherosclerosis except methotrexate, colchicine, canamycin, statins, and bivalirudin. Question number two, which of the following patients will have the highest MACE post-PCI? CRP more than 2 at baseline and at follow-up, CRP more than 2 at baseline but less than 2 at follow-up, CRP less than 2 at baseline and follow-up, CRP less than 2 at baseline but more than 2 at follow-up, or any level of CRP. This clearly from Roxana Maran's paper. Question number three, following are the independent predictor of improved prognosis with Impella used in cardiogenic shock patients except Impella CP, pre-procedure Impella, post-procedure Impella, right heart hemodynamics, and cardiac power output of 1. So with that note, we conclude our presentation, didactic and actual case presentation of today.
Sameen, exceptional case. Roxana, I want to thank you for coming and sharing your expertise on a very important topic. Final concluding remarks about this outstanding case, Anu?
No, I know. Sharma has shown all the updated trials and this and that.
But look, this was an exceptional case with great skills.
Yeah, but one trial that was not discussed that was presented during AHA is yoga.
All right, yeah. The yoga study. I love that one.
Well, so I just wanted to
what you want to do.
Yeah, but I just wanted to show you my new lead that just came through. For my birthday. All the yoga poses.
Okay. Yeah, wow. So focus it.
Focus on all the yoga poses that
are. Actually, the very nice paper, study presented in AHA by Indian centers,
yes,
that yoga after PCI.
Yeah.
All right.
No, that is rehab. Except that
that's
the standard
of
everybody.
Having women in the cath lab as cardiac rehab, actually.
Anu, start.
There's a style
start
that
the
comes to the cath lab that otherwise is not there without
start
women.
Start marketing this new lead.
That's right.
Warrior. Exactly. Concentrating right. Warrior position. Yeah. When you're doing the PCI.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Mehta. Thank you, everyone who's listening and watching.
Very, very.
And come back next month.
A very happy Thanksgiving to our viewers, and we'll see you next time, December the 18th.